Good, Stephanie. Well, you know what? I'm just a little bit hungry, so I'm going to take a big chunk out of it. You look who really want my chocolate bar now? Half of a half-eaten chocolate bar? Not many people want that chocolate bar, do they? And don't worry, because after the story, I really have chocolate bars for all of you. But you know what? Sometimes God kind of feels like that, because he wants us to love him with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our minds. And sometimes people only want to give God a tiny little part of them. And then he kind of feels like you felt when I said, well, have my half-eaten chocolate. And so God wants us to love him with our whole heart and our whole soul and our whole mind. He wants us to still love other people and things, but he wants us to put him first in our lives. And so when you take home the chocolate bars, and I'm going to give you whole chocolate bars, remember that God wants your whole heart. He wants all of your heart and mind and soul to love him. Let's pray together, and then I'll give you the chocolate bar. And just before we pray, Youth 1 is going to stay in church today. Youth 1 and Youth 2, because Carlene is away, and then the rest of you can go to your classes. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for this day, and I thank you for these dear children, Lord. And I ask that you would help them to love you with all their heart and with all their soul and with all their mind, and help each one of you, us, to put you first in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. You want to come here?
So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Thanks for the word of the Lord.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's a pleasure this morning to have Pastor Stan and Heather among us after having traveled for those long hours. Welcome back. This morning, I have the privilege to talk about a subject which sometimes is bringing some kind of controversies. But don't mind, I am not willing to bring any controversy. In fact, in some denominations and the movement, the Holy Spirit is overemphasized and leading to a Christless Pentecost, putting the Spirit exclusively on the throne and losing Jesus in the temple. Unfortunately, that kind of movement has become known for their excess in regard to the Holy Spirit's work. At the other side, other denominations and movement, the Spirit is a kind of footnote, afterthought, and even stranger. When we read the Bible, especially the Gospel of John, chapter 14 and 16, we find a long story about the work of the power that Jesus was talking about in Acts chapter 1, verses 2 to 8. And in the book of Acts, chapter 18, we find a very big picture. When Paul was in the church of Ephesus, he was asking that church, have you received the Spirit? They say, we have not even heard about it. So, we shall receive the power. It's Jesus who said that. I would like to remind everyone here that the great commandment is to love God with all we have got. The most effective way to demonstrate our love to other people, which is also the second commandment, is to share the gospel of Jesus. The most loving act would be to share Jesus with them. And the most effective way to share Jesus is to be led by the Spirit. Nowadays, we are living at a time that most of things that we could not even imagine that will happen in the world, in the society, even in the church, are rising up, making people, even Christians, to compromise about the truth which is clearly stated in the Bible. So, without being led by the power of the Holy Spirit, it will be impossible to stand on the truth that we have even known. In operation management, which is about how to make things effective, it is said that effectiveness means doing the right things to create the most value. If we are looking to share Jesus in the most way to create the best value, we have to be led by this power. One thing is very important. You shall receive the power is a promise, as read previously, from Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 8, especially verse 8, it is said, but you shall receive the power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and even to the innermost part of the earth. So, it is a promise, and once it is a promise, we can stand on it, claim it, make it ours, and live it with it. There are five questions which are raised with this power. And I would like to address all those five questions this morning. The first question which is arising is, what power is that? We will talk about it. The second question is that power promised and needed? First question, and a sub question, is it still available today? The third one would be, what power and to do what? That is very important. The fourth one will be, what are the signs of the presence of that power within somebody? And the last one, how do we get this power? Those are five questions that I will be talking about this morning. And God help me to bring it in the best way. I pray that at the end of this service, we may leave with something in our hands. Let's go. What power is that? That power is for ordinary believers and churches. You don't have to be a special person or a mega church, 10,000 of people to receive that power. It is for each single one of Christians among you, me, you, somebody else that you know. And that power has been given us into daily impact for the gospel. The church today has a celebrity. Its program, its stadium-sized churches, mega churches, as we say it today. Oh, we have even churches which have hip-hop bands. Oh, you go there, dancing, whatever. Yes, that's cool, then there is nothing bad about it. But the average Christian can feel easy, inadequate, and really pass the buck of responsibility to share the gospel. Because somebody may feel or think that sharing gospel is for pastors. Sharing gospel is for those who have been ordained. Sharing gospel is for those who are mega churches or whatever. No, sharing the gospel is for me, it is for you, it is for anybody who has accepted and committed to Jesus Christ. The more Christians we fail to feel an appropriate level of personal responsibility for the lost, the less evangelistic they become. When we don't feel burdened to those who are lost, evangelism is somehow slowing down. Be aware that most of Christians today, we have a kind of 7-Eleven God. Are you accustomed to 7-Eleven store? When you wake up at midnight, because all the stores are closed, you rush there. They are open 24 hours. You grab a snack, you grab a drink, and so on and so on. So, nowadays, Christians, we have designed a kind of 7-Eleven God to whom we go whenever we are in distress. No, that is not the God that the Bible is sharing us. That is not the God that we have believed in. He is there whenever we are looking for him. The power from God himself that is promised to those who wait on God and to follow him is the power of the Holy Spirit that lives in you and can abide upon you. Again, I come back. What is that power? It is that power for ordinary Christians and ordinary churches. It is the power to share the gospel. It is the power of personal responsibility for the lost. And that power comes from God. You need it. I need it. We all need it. Remember, the title of this topic today is You Shall Receive the Power. Are we together?
Yeah.
Let's go. Is that power needed today? Or is it still available? Most of people would say, oh, that was for the first church, first century church. Oh, don't speak about that power, it is over. Now we are living and time, don't talk about it. No, the promise of this extraordinary power, this extraordinary experience of the fullness of God in you is given, Jesus said, to enable his witnesses to take the gospel to the end of the earth. And to all the nation. According to what I know, that mission, that assignment is not yet done. Which means that power is still going on. That power is still needed now, and that power is still available now. Are we together? Mm-hmm. Power to do what? What is the purpose of that power? First, That power is provided to share God's hearts. The brand of compassion and urgency that marked Jesus' ministry will be duplicated in us. Remember, at the time that Jesus entered the temple, he found the people, they were doing some kind of other business. What did he do? He made them up and down. Okay, chase them out. Because he had realized that the church that he was attending that day was doing something that it was not called to do. So, that power is provided with the purpose of sharing God's help. That power is provided to pray God's will. In fact, the Lord links our engagement in prayer. Nowadays, prayer has become the assumed reality instead of practiced priority. What does it mean? You see somebody, he's a Christian, he's attending Grace Baptist Church, you make an assumption, yes, that person prays or not to pray. No. Instead, it has to be a practiced reality. That power is provided to pray God's will. Remember, prayer can unbolt doors, and prayer can open hearts. Most of us, we have family members, husband, children, wife, who is not committed to Jesus. Praying with the power of Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, will unbolt everything which may be locked, and it can open hearts. This power is provided to receive the guidance of the Spirit. The Spirit gives promptings in small and large ways, living in a positive of in a posture of expectation and spiritual alertness allows you, me, as a Christian, to see opportunity that God has set before us. That power is lastly provided to step through the opportunities with a boldness and ability beyond our own strength. In Acts chapter 8, verse 28, the Bible reports that the Lord spoke to an ordinary person called or named Philip. You may recall that story. Philip was an ordinary person. He was not a minister, he was not a pastor. Probably he was close to be a deacon because he was serving in the church in some way. And one day, the Lord spoke to Philip to go to Jerusalem, to go from Jerusalem to Gaza. He didn't know what he was going to do. And what the Bible reports is that Philip at that time, he took off without knowing what he would find on his way. Where many of us would come and wait for some kind of details. Remember, this generation is a generation Y. Anytime that you are bringing a question, there is a Y question is coming. Why this? What? When? Till when? How? All questions. Philip, he took off without asking any details. The voice was enough to put him in motion and go from Jerusalem to Gaza. He got led to approach a chariot that was carrying an Ethiopian government official. Remember, Philip was in Israel, And on his way, he was traveling with an Ethiopian government official. He felt the voice telling him, approach that chariot. When he approached, the Bible tells us that he heard that Ethiopian reading something from Isaiah. And he asked him, do you understand what you are reading? No, how can I? It was the opportunity to share the love, the presence, the miracle that Jesus had done some years ago. And at the end, I don't know how much time it took, but it was very short. The Ethiopian official asked, can I be baptized? Yes, Philip. Right away he said, yes, we are very close to the river. He was dumped in, baptized, and he was filled that by that power. That is the kind of power which should guide us today and nowadays, because there are many things which are raising up. Probably ministers and the pastors will not be able to get in touch with those realities. We are living them in the workplace, we are living them in our schools, we are living them in our stores, wherever to go we go. So being led by the power of the Holy Spirit will give us the opportunity to share in a kind of boldly way the love of Jesus. Now, how do we get this power? That is the most important question we have talked about. What is that power? What can we do? Now, the question is, how can we get that power? The first thing that we have to know is that we cannot get that power without prayer. In fact, in Acts chapter 4, verse 31, it is said, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. We have to be in a prayer attitude. Not praying on Sunday. Not praying when it is a meal time. Not praying because somebody is asking for it. No, praying all the time. And it doesn't have to be a very long process. It has not to be a kind of ceremony. A prayer attitude is something that should be in each single of us. We can receive that power by laying on hands. In Acts chapter 19, verse 6, the Bible says that when Paul placed his hand on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. We can receive that power by obedience. In Acts chapter 5, verse 32, the Bible tells us that we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. There is no way to get that power without obedience. Obedience to what? Obedience to the word of God, and waiting with expectation, because it is a promise. Lastly, we receive that power by surrendering. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, the Bible says, let God do in me whatever is necessary to get himself glory and to make me into the person he is after. It is what Paul means when he talks about giving ourselves to God as a living sacrifice. Surrender. Surrender about whatever we know. Surrender about whatever kind of perception. Surrender to God. Before you fill a cup, I am happy to have a cup here. Before you can fill this cup, you will make sure that it is clean. If it is dirty, it is coming from outside, having been there winter on, spring on. Can you fill water and bring it? No way. You will clean it before filling it and drink that water. That is what God is expecting from us. We must first be cleansed by Jesus before we can be indwelt by the Holy Spirit. The song that we sang this morning, I didn't have any kind of consultation with Pastor Yan when he chose this song. I was amazed to find that it was among the songs which were listed. Can we sing it together? We have to be cleansed. Let's go. Have you been to? Have you been? Can we sing together? Have you been to? Have you been to Jesus for greetings bound? Are you washing the blood of the Lamb? I brought up another version. Anyway, the fact is that we cannot be filled without being cleansed by the power of Jesus Christ. Are we together? Last question that I want to address today, and this will give us a kind of insight about what is going on in my life, in your life. Again, it is about personal relationship with the Lord. When you have that power, the Spirit glorifies and testifies of Christ. The first question is this one. What kind of words are coming out of your mouth most of the time? Are they words which are glorifying and which are testifying of Christ? The Spirit teaches us how to pray. Have you been taught how to pray? When you are praying, do you feel that connection with the Lord? There is a time when we want to pray, we have to look around. Who is beside me? Who is behind me? Who is up front of me? No. When you have that power, no matter who is surrounding you, you will feel that you are driven into that spirit of prayer. The Spirit anoint us for ministry. Are you scared whenever you are in front of somebody who is unsaved, who doesn't know Jesus? Are you thinking about the way that you should afford that situation? Or do you feel bold to go and speak about Jesus? The Spirit reveals the deep things. What about those deep things? About the Word of God. Discovering, reading one verse and having a kind of meaning which has never been revealed. You get a desire to hear God's Word. You get a desire for repentance, turning from sin, a desire to love others, an increase in your knowledge and understanding of God, and most importantly, you get that joy, that love, that peace, that forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, as it is stated in our Bible from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 up to 23. The question would be this one: do you perceive some of those signs in your life? If yes, praise God. If no, the promise is for you. I would like to come to this conclusion saying that it is the Holy Spirit that gives you the power, the strength, the boldness, the ability, and the confidence to be witnesses for Jesus. You cannot do it by your own. The question is one: are you filled with that power? Am I filled with that power? Do you need to be filled with that power? Remember, in Acts chapter 19, at the time that Apostle Paul was asking the church of Ephesus, have you received the power of the Holy Spirit when you got baptized? They said, we have not even heard about it. This morning, I asked to somebody, have you heard about the Holy Spirit? The same response as in Ephesus, he said, no, I have never. I told him, be aware, I will be talking about that now. Here we are. We need that power. I need that power. Each single one needs that power to be witnessing in the best and effective way for Jesus Christ. That is what we have been called for. That is our calling. That is our duty. Please, let's ask for that power. God bless you. I would like to end this by praying. The prayer this morning will be nothing else than asking for being, receiving that power. It may come in many ways. It may be manifested in many ways. But remember, the purpose of that power is for the great work of the gospel and sharing Jesus with others in their own way. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the promise of the power of Holy Spirit. We have surrendered to you with the best of our ability, and now we want each single one here to be filled with that power. We need that power in our life, Lord. Lord, we believe that when we surrendered to you, we became one with you. You are the vine, and we are the branches. We need that power to witness to this hardened world. Only in your power, guided by your Spirit, can our life be fruitful. Holy Spirit, come to each single one here this morning. We want it. We want it and want stretch us, Lord, and make us to be the people who want to be in this world. We will not limit your gifts to our perceptions of what we can handle. Holy Spirit, expand our capacity in doing your assignment. Work in us in a powerful way. We want your purpose to be done in our life in order to be fruitful. Come, power of the Holy Spirit. Come to everyone. In Jesus' name I pray. Let us say, Amen.